Good morning. This is the week we've been looking forward to for a while, isn't it? That this is the week in which we will see all kinds of characters at our home seeking treats and goodies. It's going to be a good week. Today we look around here and we see all kinds of characters around us as well, don't we? Not wearing masks and costumes. Well, ignore the guy behind the pulpit. But we come seeking not treats, but a sense of meaning and purpose. We come hoping to be confronted by our God, who always seeks to give us good things. So welcome to worship at Kernersville Moravian Church. Whether you are here in our sanctuary or joining us online, we are glad that you have chosen to spend these moments with us. If there are ways in which we can be of assistance to you, please do not hesitate to let us know. That's why we are here. There are all kinds of things coming up. Next Sunday, we will be celebrating communion. The week after that, we have our love feast. But do not fret about today. There is food available today. Immediately after worship, our preschool will be having their spaghetti luncheon. I hope you will stick around for the food, but also the fellowship. If you can't stick around, there are to-go plates, and you can get one of those. It's only $10, and those funds help support this vital ministry of our church, our preschool. There are several other events coming up in the life of our church, not the least of which is our church council meeting on November 12th. I hope you're planning on being with us that day after worship. We don't have these often, but when we do, they're important. And there are some important items that we need to be taking a look at that day. We will look at our financial outlook for this year and also for next year. We'll be reviewing and voting on some revisions for our graveyard committee and also the nominations for our boards and committees for next year. There are copies of these nominations and regulation revisions in the back. Please pick one of those up as you leave. I want to offer my deep appreciation to those who have done such work preparing us for this meeting. Thanks to them, but also thanks to those who have agreed to serve. It does take a lot of people to make church happen. As we come to worship today, we want to offer our sympathies and prayers for the family of Francis Slade, who entered into the more immediate presence of our God this past week. Memorial service will be held on November 4th, next Saturday, at Pierce Jefferson Funeral Home at 11 o'clock. John Wrights will be conducting that service. Please keep them in your prayers during this time. We've come to worship this day. And on this day, we also come remembering the saints who have gone on before us, those who have shown us the way. As we worship, let us offer our thanksgiving to them, pledging to follow in the way that they have shown us. Welcome to worship.
Thank you.
invite you to stand as we join together in our litany found on page 105 in our worship guides. May we stand together. Behold, a great multitude which no one can number, out of every nation of all tribes and people and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb with palm branches in their hands. These are the ones of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains and in caves and in holes in the ground. They were stoned to death. They were sawn in two. They were slain with the sword. They were burned at the stake. They were killed by assassin's bullet. They were destitute, persecuted, tormented. These are the ones who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and cleansed them in the blood of the Lamb. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and will guide them to springs of living water.
And God shall wipe away every tear from their eyes.
Almighty God, Redeemer and Sustainer, we offer you thanks and praise for the holy lives of all your servants, the prophets, apostles, martyrs, who have shone forth as lights in the world and sacrificed their lives in testimony of their faith. We thank you for the triumphant fellowship of all the saints in glory. We remember before you all have been called to the more immediate presence of the Savior, especially those most dear to us in our congregation. We rejoice in our present fellowship with them, in our continuing hope, and in the promise of eternal joy. Let the great cloud of witnesses, the innumerable company of those who have gone before and entered into rest, be to us an example of godly life. May we run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. And may we obtain entrance into your eternal kingdom, and with the glorious assembly of the saints, worship and adore you. Are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake.
For theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
What shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword?
No. In all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loves us. If God is for us, who can be against us?
Hear the words of the Amen. The faithful and true witness, who is dead and is alive again. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life.
To him who loves us and washed us from our sins by his blood, and made us to be a kingdom, priests to God, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
be seated. Will you hear these words of our Lord from the 11th chapters of Hebrews? Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Indeed, by faith our ancestors received approval. What more should I say? For time would fail me to tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, of David and Samuel, the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, obtained promises, shut the mouths of lions, quenched raging fire, escaped the edge of sword, won strength out of weakness, became mighty in war, put foreign armies to flight. Women received their dead by resurrection. Others were tortured, refusing to accept release in order to obtain a better resurrection. Others suffered mocking and flogging, and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned to death. They were sawn in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in skins of sheep and goat, destitute, persecuted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in caves and mountains and in holes in the ground. Yet all these, though they were commended for their faith, did not receive what was promised, since God had provided something better, so they would not, apart from us, be made perfect. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. I want to invite our children to join me for a moment together. We're going to switch it up a bit today. Have a seat over here on this pew, and I'm going to come over to you, okay? Come on. Okay, you're going to have to scrunch together a little bit because we have a couple more. Okay, squeeze, squeeze, squeeze. Okay, one more. Slide down just a little bit. Okay, we're good? Okay. I wasn't here last week. We tried something week before. Let's try it again. Good morning.
Good morning.
Gosh, you are so good. Are you ready for this week? Do you have your costumes? Yes? Yeah? My grandson sent me his mother sent me a video of him in his costume this coming week. He's going to go as Blippi. Do you know Blippi?
Yes.
Of course you do. Do you know Blippi?
Yep.
Parents do. The rest of you, YouTube it. You'll love it. Maybe not. But you know, Halloween is really the night before another big day. What are you going to do on Wednesday? Anything? You know, because you know what? Wednesday really is the great big day. Wednesday is All Saints' Day. Halloween is All Hallows' Eve. We get it. Halloween is actually more fun. Let's be honest. But on All Saints Day, we remember saints. Do you know what a saint is? Sure you do. It's a person that plays football for New Orleans. That's my team. They're not good this year. None of my teams are good this year. But that's another story. A saint, though, is not the football players. A saint, well, how do you describe a saint? Some people say a saint is a very, 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 very good person. Somebody that is almost perfect. But you know what the Bible says? I'm going to show you a saint, okay? Look. Look. The Bible says that any of us who seek to follow Jesus are saints. You are a saint. Caleb, did you know that? You're a saint. So this week, when your mother says, "Who do you think you are?" You know what you say? "I'm a saint." That doesn't mean we're always going to get it right. Sometimes we don't get it right at all. Sometimes I don't. Ask my wife. But a saint means someone who is always seeking to follow Jesus. To say, okay, where is Jesus going? What is Jesus trying to do in our world? And how can I help? So this week, after you get your costumes on Tuesday night, on Wednesday morning, I want you to get up. You go to school. You do all the stuff you need to do. I want you to remember, today I'm going to be a saint. Let's pray. God, thank you for the saints who have gone on before us, who have shown us the way. Even more, God, I thank you for these saints who are here with us today. Help us to follow you, to be your saint. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you so very much. For all the saints, those who have gone before, also those who are around us. Invite us to join, to stand if you are able, and join us in singing our hymn, number 390, "For All the Saints." We gather here today in a building that we did not build, that was provided by us by saints who have gone before us. We hope to give that gift, that legacy, to people who come after us. May that be our inspiration as we give this day. Let us pray. God, we are the recipients of so many wonderful gifts from those who came before us. We offer these gifts back to you in hopes that they might be an inspiration and ministry to those we will never see. We offer this prayer in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. I told our children that I make mistakes all the time, not the least of which was in the worship guide this week. I left out the prayer, so we're going to do some reorganization. Hang on. We're going to hear our scripture lesson and then our morning prayer before the anthem, before the sermon. Many things I am not, inerrant is not one of them. From the book of Deuteronomy, we hear these words of our Lord. Then Moses went up from the plains of Moab to Mount Nebo, to the top of Pisgah, which is opposite Jericho, and the Lord showed him the whole land, Gilead as far as Dan, all of Naphtali, the land of Ephraim and Manasseh, all the land of Judah as far as the western sea, the Negev and the plain, that is the valley of Jericho, the city of palm trees, as far as Zoar. The Lord said to him, "This is the land which I swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, saying, I will give it to your descendants. I have let you see it with your own eyes, but you shall not cross over there." Then Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab at the Lord's command. He was buried in the valley in the land of Moab opposite Beth Peor, but no one knows his burial place to this day. Moses was 120 years old when he died. His sight was unimpaired, and his vigor had not abated. The Israelites wept for Moses in the plain of Moab 30 days. Then the mourning, period of mourning for Moses was ended. Joshua, son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom because Moses had laid his hands on him, and the Israelites obeyed him, doing as the Lord had commanded Moses. Never since has there arisen a prophet in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. He was unequaled for all the signs and wonders that the Lord sent him to perform in the land of Egypt against Pharaoh and all his servants and his entire land, and for all his mighty deeds and all the terrifying displays of power that Moses performed in the sight of all Israel. This is the word of our Lord. Thanks be to God. As we pray together, we do want to remember the Slade family. Also ask that you remember Pete Chapman and his family. Pete is now a patient at Trellis in Winston-Salem. I saw Pete and Joanne yesterday, and he is actually doing much, much better. But we want to continue to remember him and them in our prayers. Let us pray together. God, it has been a week in which horror has become real. We watched as a town in Maine, not much larger than Kernersville, became the latest to suffer a mass shooting. 18 men, women, and children gunned down as they ate a meal, bowled, played cornhole with their friends. In the aftermath, a town, a region was locked down as law enforcement officials searched for the perpetrator, and he was found, another victim. But God, this event spread far beyond Maine. It hit the towns, the families of previous victims. It hit other towns that ask, when will it come here? God, it appears that it really is a question of when. We have to confess that our legislators, ourselves, we've chosen to worship at the altar of Mars, the god of war, rather than worship you. We have cared more for our rights and the lives of children and others. But God, it's not just in this country. Also this week, we have watched the horrific reports coming out of Israel, of Gaza, of the escalating conflict. There, thousands have been slaughtered. hundreds taken hostage, untold numbers terrified, not knowing what might come next, with no place to flee. It's another incident growing from a millennial-old conflict between cousins. It's taking place in the land you led Moses through, in the land Jesus walked. And it continues even this morning. God, we confess that we fear it is only a preview of our future. For too long, we've had so many long-seated conflicts that we have refused to address. We allow our self-interest to divide us to the point that, well, we wonder when what we see in the Middle East might come to Middle America. God, that's why we come to you. We come this day asking you to speak to our hearts, those that are broken, those that are afraid, those that are hardened. We pray that you will heal us and mold us into your image, for that is our prayer. It is the one your Son taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
For all those
have that thing, that item that you just can't imagine living without? I'm not talking about a person. I'm talking about a thing. I do. Actually, I have several, but the one thing that I did ask for when Anita and I got married years and years and years ago was a programmable coffee pot, one that would have my coffee ready when I got up in the morning. We've gone through several. It's one of those items that if or when it breaks, there's another one in the house before the sun sets. I just can't live without it. I feel almost that way about our microwave. I know a lot of people who use that appliance just to thaw things, to warm leftovers up. But I believe in cooking in a microwave. I did our Thanksgiving turkey one year. But I did it. And it wasn't that bad. Our microwave ranks right up there with my coffee pot. But the one item that I can't imagine being without is my iPad. My first one was a present from my family over 10 years ago. Anita said, "We know how much you want one, but you would never buy it for yourself." And she was right then. But now, can't imagine being without it. It's how I read my multiple newspapers every morning. It's how I keep up with what's going on in multiple worlds. It's how I watch movies when I'm away. It's how I preach. Anita has this horrible fear that one Sunday, I'm going to come in here and it's going to go boop. If and when that happens, it'll be a very, very short service. When we were in Bali, we came home one day to discover that our house had been broken into. Someone had come in, taken all kinds of stuff, including both of our computers. I was devastated, to say the least, but I had my iPad so I could still preach. Recently, I left it on an airplane. I was past security, just past security when I realized it. And no matter how much you beg and plead, how much you assure them that that's all you want to do, they will not let you go back through that way. By the time some official went back to retrieve it, the plane had left to go to Charlotte, where it stayed for 2 weeks. I knew it was there because I could track it on my phone through the heroic work of Latrice in American baggage change. Baggage control in Greensboro, we were reunited and it felt so good. But those 2 weeks, I didn't know what was happening in the world. I didn't know how to preach. You may remember, I preached off my computer for those 2 weeks. I was one lost puppy. This is my item. It's my item, but there are times when it gets messy. I mean, literally messy. I love the fact that I can touch the screen, moving things around like John King on election night. But all that movement means that fingerprints get all over it. There's smudges, sometimes to the point that it's hard for me to read through all those smudges. That's when I have to pull out my handy-dandy cleaning cloth and spray some stuff on it. Do a heavy cleaning to restore it. That cleaning helps me see what I need to see. But there are other smudges, other fingerprints that I dare not wipe away. We call those smudges saints. Our text this morning recounts some of them. Our Hebrew text tells about the death of Moses, the saint before there were saints. That one who led the Hebrew children to freedom. that escaped bondage in Egypt, wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. And now, just as they were getting ready to cross over the Jordan into the promised land, Moses dies. Now, let me say, it is easy to get distracted in this story by all the whys. As I was reading the commentaries this week, everyone wanted to ask that question. Why? Why? It doesn't seem fair. I mean, we could spend a lot of time asking that question, talking about the unfairness of it all. At the end of it, though, we would discover there's no real reason, at least not a good reason. There isn't even a consistent reason. Text says that Moses died, and he was buried in an unmarked grave. Some rationalize that Moses died and was buried in an unmarked grave so that people would move on and not continue to worship, make a shrine out of his grave. We do have a tendency to do that, don't we, to our heroes? Have you been to Graceland? Saints aren't given for us to worship. Saints always point us beyond, to the God they follow, to the one they invite us to follow. People like those listed in the Saints Hall of Fame in Hebrews. The author talks about Moses and then says, I could go on and on, but I've run out of time. There are so many more. Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, Samuel, David, the prophets. Through acts of faith, they toppled kingdoms, made justice work, took the promises for themselves. They were protected from lions, fires, and swords, turned disadvantages into advantages, won battles, routed alien armies. None of these people, even though their lives of faith were exemplary, got their hands on what was promised. God had a better plan for them and for us, that their faith and our faith would come together to make one completed whole. Their lives of faith not complete apart from ours. Their faith and our faith would come together to make one completed whole. Their lives, their smudges left on us, help make our lives complete. When I think about my life, there are fingerprints of men and women who have shaped and molded my life, the veritable saints that I have known. They weren't stoned or sawn in two. They weren't vagrants wandering around in animal skins, but they were saints. They were saints. They would blush and stammer if they ever heard their name associated with a saint, but saints they were. Some of them have passed into that great cloud of witnesses. Ed Chrisman, who was chaplain at Wake Forest, who was the first minister I ever knew, who was a real person. He introduced me to people who opened doors to my life and my career. If you come down to my office, you will see a picture of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. that hung in his office at Wake Forest. His daughter gave it to me. And every time I walk in, every time I see that picture, I see through the smudges of Ed Chrisman, Hardy Clemens. It is not an understatement to say that without Hardy, I would not be in ministry today. He was my boss in Greenville, then nurtured into a mentor, and eventually a dear, dear friend. The other week I was walking to the office, and I had the thought, I so wish I could talk to Hardy. I can't do that. He passed away several years ago. But I wanted to hear his voice, and I found an interview online, that gave me the opportunity at least again to hear his voice. Hardy came to speak once in our church in Charleston while I was away, and Anita introduced him by saying, "You've never heard Hardy Clemons, but you've heard him. Because at his best, Don is an echo of Hardy." She was right. I'm always looking through his influence, asking myself, WWHD, what would Hardy do? Mac Bryan, professor at Wake Forest that took me to England. We weren't buddies. We locked horns. He threw me out of class one morning for bringing a biscuit with jelly in it. One night, my roommate, who I just had lunch with just a few months ago, Gordon asked me one night as we were going to bed, "Don, why does Dr. Bryan hate you so much?" We didn't like each other. I think one reason was Mac Bryan was a prophet. One morning in the fall of 1978, his daughter came in to say, "Dad's not going to be at class today. He's at the South African embassy protesting apartheid." In 1978, I turned to one of my friends and said, "What's apartheid?" Few people outside that country knew what it was, of the injustice that was going on, but Dr. Bryan did, and he felt compelled to do something. He was a man of passion, driven by his faith to make a difference. I didn't like him. He didn't like me. But after I got back from England, every now and then I'd be walking across campus, and I would hear his words come out of my mouth. And when I was in the hospital, Dr. Bryan was the one professor who came to see me. Mac Bryan taught me that faith is full of passion and will cost you. These are just a few of the professional Christians whose lives have left an imprint on my life. But there are countless others whose names will never appear in a book. People like Gene Marin, a retired Navy captain, who after he retired, loaded his orange van with enough tools and equipment and stuff that we used to joke that he could build pretty much anything, and he did. He volunteered constantly with Habitat for Humanity, and every summer, he was our youth mission trip construction coordinator. He taught our youth how to roof a building, how to build stairs. But even more on those trips, he was building lives. And the question all the youth would ask every summer was, "Is Mean Gene going?" There were people like Lydia Bean and Corliss DeVinny and Susan Shelley, who achieved sainthood through pots of vegetable soup and fried chicken and peach cobblers. There are people like Phyllis Philbeck and James Robert Beam, who were always on the bus when our youth went anywhere. People like Joe Alexander, who was there every week, teaching a bunch of adolescent boys and then taking us out to play softball. People like Jen Williams, who was old, gosh, Jen Williams was old, probably my age old, who taught us the importance of missions. And people like Brianna McIntosh, who is the age of my daughter. But when she was watching the news one night and saw that young boy from Syria who washed up on shores of Greece in that orange life jacket. And she looked at him and she said, he's the same age as Denver, her son. She went to church the next Sunday and said, we have to do something. Now that little church in Nova Scotia has helped resettle at least 10 families from the warfare in Syria. Saints, everyone, who continue to point me towards God. People who help make me complete who I'm supposed to be. Who are those people for you? Can you see their faces? Can you hear their voices? My guess is that there might even be some of them sitting in this room with you this morning. Those men and women who have helped shape your life, taught you what it means to be a person of faith, who have shown you how to live, who have given you an example to follow. Who are those people? This week, at the very least, I hope you will offer a prayer of thanksgiving for them. If possible, give them a call. Drop them a note to let them know how much they have impacted your life. I can promise you it will be the best thing that happens to them this week, this month, maybe this year. See, our lives are smudged with the fingerprints of those saints in our lives. But the question I want to ask you is, on whose life are you leaving smudges? It may come as a surprise to you, but it's happening. It's happening when people see you serving at Bethany Cafe, serving as an usher, serving as a deaner during our love feast, singing in the choir, playing in the band, just doing work around our church. It's happening when you take the time to learn the names of our children and then say hello to them and call their name at church, letting them know that they are welcomed and wanted here. It happens. It happens when we offer our financial gifts, making sure that the ministry of this church, the one that was begun over 150 years ago, has been nurtured through the ages, the ministry that has impacted your life, impacts the lives of so many in our community, might continue to thrive into the future. This week, as you look at the world, as you look at your life, at your faith, know that you will be looking through, you'll be looking through the smudges of so many. Give thanks to God for them. But even more, this week, consider where you are leaving your fingerprints. May they be such that years from now, a few people will be saying, you know, when I think back about saints, the person that helped shape my life was yours. Amen. I invite you to stand if you are able and join us in singing our hymn 698, Our Forebears Lived by Faith. thank you for being a part of worship today. I hope that you're going to join us for our spaghetti luncheon. I can see the desserts from here. If you're going to get it, you might want to stay, because if you're going to get a to-go plate, you just get pound cake. I'm sorry. If you stay, you get your choice of desserts. It's a great deal at $10. We go from this place to live out the faith that has been given to us. A short story. Each week, at the close of our service, I share a benediction with you. And some people have said, "That's so good. I really like that." And I'm like, "Yeah, I stole it." It was the benediction that I heard my pastor in seminary, Steve Shoemaker, who's now a pastor down in Statesville, do week after week after week. And I thought it was original with Steve. I was having a conversation with him one day, and I found out that he, too, had stolen it. He'd gotten it from William Sloan Coffin, who for many years was the pastor at Riverside Church in New York City. And one year, several years before he passed away, I had the great fortune to have lunch with Dr. Coffin. And as we were sitting there, I asked him about it. And I said, "Did you do that?" And he paused for a moment. He said, Yeah, I did." And I asked him, I said, "Do you mind if I borrow it?" He said, "Oh, please do. Please do." What you do will ripple through the ages. Your compassion, your words, your actions have impact far beyond what you will ever see. So, as we close, will you hear the words of our benediction from William Sloan Coffin, from Steve Shoemaker, and from me? You are the people of God. So go now, and as you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God give you grace never to sell yourself short. Grace to risk something big for something good. Grace to remember that our world is too dangerous for anything but truth and too small for anything but love. So go now. And as you go, may the Lord take your hands and work through them. May the Lord take your lips and speak through them. May the Lord take your hearts and set them on fire, both now and forevermore.